Welcome back to Exchange's Deep Dive, The Battle for Our Screens. In the first episode, we talked about the rise in streaming and how movie theaters are adapting to this new world of at-home entertainment. In this episode, we're going to look at how work has changed. Many of us have been hopping on Zoom meetings with colleagues, but the digital shift goes much further and deeper than that. And there are a couple new tools and platforms that are poised to change how we work forever. We'll hear from Heather Bellini of our research division, Marco Argenti, our firm's co-CIO or chief information officer, and Ryan Nolan, who works in our investment banking division. Then we'll wrap up with a client interview from Renee James, CEO of Ampere Computing, a semiconductor startup, to hear about her vision for the modern workforce. First up, we have Heather Bellini and Heath Terry from our research division. They'll provide some data behind how we work and how productivity has changed since the pandemic began.
So Heather, before we dive in, what are some of the headline numbers of a few of the key stats that you're watching related to workplace technology?
So we're looking at 1.25 billion knowledge workers today. That is the starting point for everything that we're focused on. We're looking at where people are in the S-curve in terms of penetration of different technology trends. So one of the biggest trends, Heath, and it would be related to public cloud penetration. 10% penetration as we exited 2019. Our CIO surveys would suggest that we'll be over 40% when we look 3 years out. We've had companies like Zoom go from adding 30,000 customers roughly in 2019 to already adding over 150,000 customers in the first quarter of 2020. So you've seen these massive accelerations, and we expect to see in things like public cloud even more acceleration as we look ahead.
What would you say are some of the biggest overarching trends or responses that you've seen at the enterprise level?
So I think to look forward, you actually have to look back a little bit. And so I'm going to give you a little bit of a brief history on kind of how we've evolved from a technology perspective. So we look at technology cycles as happening every 20 years, and we're just at the beginning of a new one. If you go back from the 60s to 1980s, it was mainframe computers that characterized where we were. The 1980s to 2000s was defined by things like client servers and bold goals, such as getting a PC on every desk. And it was also the start of the commercialization of the internet. The last 20 years, 2000 to 2020, it was all about web architectures. It was about API, application programming interface connectivity, and it was the start of public cloud and software as a service. Enterprise 4.0, which we call it, is going to leverage these 1.25 billion knowledge workers that we mentioned, and it's going to be an era that's defined by disparate workforces. And so we think it's going to change all sorts of the ways we communicate and interact with people day to day. It's going to be areas like collaboration, areas like video, that would be things like Zoom. Collaboration would be things like Slack or Microsoft Teams. And it's not going to stop there. You're going to start to see wholesale replacement of some of these legacy technologies that have just been still in use and just haven't had a reason for them to change up until now. PBXs, what you used to have from the 1960s, is still around today. We're going to have unified communications as a service. You're going to be able to have your phone number follow you around. You're going to have things like project management applications, anything that will help distributed workforces work together on shared tasks. So there's a bunch of these different trends, and I just named a couple of them, that are going to define what we think happen over the next 20 years.
You know, when you look at what individual companies are doing, and obviously this cuts across everything from giants like Microsoft and Google and Amazon to, you know, small startups, are there any specific examples that you've seen of technology adoption accelerating that we wouldn't have seen without this environment?
I think Satya Nadella of Microsoft summed it up the best when, on his earnings call last quarter, this was the March quarter, said that we've seen 2 years of digital transformation occur in 2 months. And I think that's exactly right, especially in key areas. So a few notable accelerations to get to your specific question, and I kind of alluded to it before, but Zoom added over 180,000 customers where they have over 11 employees in the March quarter. They added only 31,000 for all of 2019. So, I mean, just massive uptake in the use of their technology that I think everyone has probably used at some point over the last 6 months. Microsoft's employee collaboration product, which is called Teams, they've seen the year-over-year growth of its unique users average around 900% since the pandemic began. DocuSign, so, is still seeing unique user growth well above its pre-pandemic levels. And I think we've, again, something else everyone's probably used, especially over the last 6 months, as documents are almost always being signed digitally today. So those are just a couple of the examples that really stand out.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I think one of the things that, you know, we're certainly all feeling is the replacement of travel. And, you know, everybody in our industry has talked for, you know, decades about video conferencing replacing travel. And now we're in a world where we have no choice but for that to be the case. How much of this do you think sticks when we go back to whatever normal is going to look like?
So, you know, in terms of how much will stick when we're finally out of the pandemic, look, there is, and you hear people talk about tech fatigue or Zoom fatigue. There are people who long for the personal interactions. And I think there's people who are perfectly happy, you know, kind of continuing what they're doing, working remotely and just communicating as needed. But ultimately, you know, my view in all of this has been some of this technology adoption is here to stay. So for example, you know, you and I used to jump on planes to go to one meeting in whatever part of the globe. That might not happen as much anymore. You won't get as much pushback if you offer to do a meeting in London or in Hong Kong for an hour remotely versus what you might have had to do before, going to California for an hour-long meeting. And I think that will become more commonplace for that to take the place of travel. But I also think that people typically move, when you look back at technology trends, people usually move too far to the extreme. So while everyone's saying, you know, no one's going to travel anymore for business meetings, you know, it's probably not going to be, again, as I mentioned, as much travel as what we had before, but I think it's probably going to be somewhere in the middle. So some of these trends are certainly going to see their momentum continue. And I think the other way to think about it is, they've reached a penetration rate or will reach a penetration rate that's just at a much higher level than people would have assumed before. So whether that's desktop as a service, where people used to estimate that 30% of all desktops would be penetrated, that number might be now more like 60%. Or you have things like application performance monitoring or APM technology. It's 10%, 5 to 10% penetrated today. People are talking about that being 60% penetrated and getting there over a much shorter curve than what it would have been had this not happened. And so, again, I think it's more about we'll end up kind of meeting the pendulum somewhat closer to the middle than the extremes that everyone's talking about. But some of these, in terms of how we communicate and collaborate, I do think are here to stay.
You and your teams have done a lot of incredible work on the adoption and the rate of adoption of cloud computing well before this pandemic started. What has this kind of business continuity need that I don't think anybody ever obviously anticipated something happening at this level done to that pace of cloud adoption?
So again, at the end of 2019, we were about 10% penetrated in the cloud based on the firm's survey work. And 3 years out, we think this can top 40%. And there's still plenty of room for it to go outside of that three-year period. It is, in terms of the pace of adoption, it has been accelerated as a result of the cloud. New workloads were already going to the cloud, but it will usher in an even faster migration of existing workloads to the cloud. So if you're a startup or a company formed in the last 10 years, most of your workloads are already in the cloud. But if you're a company that's been around for 50, 100, 150 years, you certainly have most of your technology that's still on premise. And it's the conversations we're having with people suggest that the conversations are happening even more aggressively now to try and shift more of that to the cloud so they can, you know, again, trade things like capital expenditures for operating expenditures. But more importantly, to get better resiliency and to get better, to get their arms around their technology and being able to spin up new applications and new workloads without having to have people physically present.
One of the other trends that maybe we've seen accelerated by this, I mean, obviously there was a big push of people bringing their own technology into the workplace, you know, something that really started with iPhones, but, you know, spread with companies like Dropbox using kind of consumer adoption of technology to infiltrate the workplace. Are you seeing that accelerate or change in any way because of this pandemic?
So, you know, it's an interesting question because there's a couple trends going on. So you have seen what is referred to as top of funnel accelerate for a lot of technology companies that are offering these types of collaboration services, of which you can put Dropbox in that category. People like Slack, Microsoft Teams would be in those categories. And it's going to be a question of conversion. So there's been a lot of offering of, there's free products people could use, and ultimately it'll depend on conversion to paid products. It's people trying with getting discounts on initial deployments. And I think a lot of the tech companies have learned from the internet companies that you focus on that you can figure out monetization sometimes later, but it's better to get someone using your products today, even if you have to give them a discount or even offer a free subscription, and you'll figure out a way or you'll ultimately monetize a percentage of those down the road. And so I do think a lot of these tech companies in those areas have tried to learn from some of the internet companies and how they do things. So you have seen adoption of those products accelerate. But what's interesting is you also have this dynamic where there is a little bit of austerity around IT budgets today, given the global GDP picture. And because of that, you know, it puts people like Microsoft in an interesting position because Microsoft can offer, in many cases, a lot of these products bundled into things like Office 365 and make it so it's at least worth people's time to try it before they may go out and buy a product from another vendor that they actually have to pay for. And so it's going to be interesting to see how austerity in IT budgets impacts adoption of suite providers, such as what Microsoft is offering, versus in some cases, like a company like offering, you know, kind of file sync and share and document management capabilities, where you would have to pay separately for it. So I think it's going to be interesting to see over the next, you know, kind of 6 to 12 months, how that conversion of top of funnel occurs.
That's great, Heather. I think we're all really looking forward to continuing to hear from you as this all evolves.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Heather and Heath. In the middle of March, our company, like so many others, had to quickly and unexpectedly make a huge and sudden shift to working from home. In our case, 98% of our employees made that switch within about 1 week. The migration was a huge team effort all around. One of the people helping spearhead it was Marco Argenti, Goldman Sachs' co-chief information officer. We sat down with Marco to talk about how something that once seemed impossible happened almost overnight.
It was obviously a big undertaking to move the entire workforce to work from home in such a small amount of time. And I'm going to talk about a little bit of the process that we followed. So we knew that it was possible in the long term. We actually kind of envisioned the future where this kind of more digital communication between people would become more and more the norm. But definitely what we were not prepared for was like such a sudden acceleration, almost like, you know, evolving 5 years in like a matter of weeks. And so there were, you know, a few considerations that were at the center of the discussion. One is, you know, are we actually positioned to transition from a system standpoint and from a desktop environment standpoint? And the good news there is that given the fact that, you know, years ago, we chose to go for a fully virtualized desktop environment. So, you know, your desktop is really like a thin client and, you know, your applications are really running in our data centers. That full virtualization was kind of a really important ingredient for making it really possible to virtually be able to work from anywhere, as long as you have a capable internet connection, first and foremost, and then you also have, let's say, a large enough screen, and then you have a computer that doesn't need to be incredibly powerful, but needs to be able to successfully run a thin client. And so let's say that the requirements for running this kind of virtualized environment were much less than the requirements of actually having applications and data installed in your own desktop. So that was a really important enabler. We assembled and shipped over like 3,500 phone at home kits and 3,500 workplace kits with monitors, computers, keyboards, and mouse for people that were not equipped properly. And then we uplifted our login.js and added redundant connectivity. And at the end, you know, we were able to manage over 32,000 concurrent users at its peak. And generally, that was like, you know, maybe a tenth of that prior to the crisis. And, you know, Zoom was really a game changer for Goldman. And it's kind of sometimes being referred to as a sort of a global equalizer. And so that was rolled out to all 40,000 employees in a matter of days. And obviously, you know, when you roll out a new tool, you also need to expect that people will have questions. And so the help desk was also uplifted and did an extraordinary job answering a record number of calls. So, you know, we experienced like up to 46% year-over-year increase in volumes of calls in February, March, and then peaking during the week of March the 20th, where there was as much as a 72% increase in volumes. And then volumes have normalized as people were starting to establish work from home setups. And then, you know, the thing is like, you know, you kind of have this perfect storm situations where not only you need to move all this amount of people to work in a different environment, but also there's events happening around you. And so at the very same time, we had this sequence of events of, you know, unprecedented market volatility and volumes, which obviously resulted into an incredible stress front and middle office and back office systems. And, you know, our operations team needed to work really, really hard in order to keep within their compliance windows and regulatory obligations. You know, there was uplift of the way we kind of process like reconciliations. And we went from like jobs that used to take multiple hours to, you know, taking like fractions of hours. And that really helped us in a time of extreme volatility. We, you know, had events like oil future prices went going negative, which was almost like a mini Y2K problem, if you know what I mean. Like, you know, you have something that, you know, was unprecedented and computers could have reacted and software could have reacted in a very unpredictable way. And that actually went quite well. At one point, we even had an earthquake in Salt Lake City as all this was happening. And so we were kind of, you know, feeling almost like in one of those impossible simulation games. So it was really testing us to the limit. So those are some of the highlights. If I look at the future, even after a large percentage of the employees are going to be back in the office, I'm reflecting that, you know, a lot of the changes that we went through might actually persist. And there are some technologies that we'll continue to use on a daily basis. The way we adapted to this new normal is also something that we believe, that I believe is actually going to last in the future. One of the things that we learned is that at least for the engineering population, we saw that productivity was really not impacted by the change of environment. So, you know, we looked at several metrics that could be linked to employee productivity, such as, for example, the number of check-ins on code repositories. And those actually, if anything, they went slightly up. You know, there seems to be lesson with regards to some job categories can really work from anywhere very productively. There's a human element that I think actually will last, probably the most important one, which is that this crisis, maybe being all together facing a situation of difficulty, and also the ability to really like instantly kind of be all on the same page and having meetings that happened virtually and did not require physical movement, created a sort of a equalization between people around the world. Nobody felt like a second-class citizen, no matter where they were, like almost like the concept of headquarters kind of changed, and it became almost like one single global headquarter, which was an interesting thing. And I think this idea of building bridges and really having people establish really strong personal relationships in a moment of crisis is something that will last, of course, hopefully beyond this. I would say that also from a tools perspective, you know, some of the changes that we've done to our systems and some of the tools that we now have at our disposal, like obviously Zoom and Jabber, and the use of Symfony that now is becoming more and more pervasive, are something that will actually help us be more productive. And it will help us, you know, maintain a level of flexibility that I think will be very helpful so that, you know, people that have specific situations and specific needs will be able to eventually also have a flexible work schedule that, you know, without impacting productivity. So I think we're more ready in general for change. We're more equipped for episodes like this that might happen in the future, hopefully not. We're definitely more used to be productive and flexible at the same time. And then I think, you know, ultimately we really feel a little bit closer together than we've been before. And I think those things combined will probably bring some positive change in the future.
Thank you, Marco. Now over to Ryan Nolan of our investment banking division. Ryan will talk about the future of work and the companies he works with in Silicon Valley and beyond that are developing the next generation of digital productivity. Welcome, Ryan.
Hey, good morning, Jake. Good to be with you.
So, Ryan, you've said that you think the future of work is the biggest prize in software. Why do you say that, and what's the strategic lens with which to view this opportunity?
I think the simplest formulation of that thesis, Jake, is that there are over 1.25 billion knowledge workers around the world. And while we've all experienced an incredible explosion in apps and communication tools to maintain and accelerate our connectivity, the fundamental tools that we use throughout our workday to actually get work done hasn't really changed that much in the last 20 years. The data would tell us that we spend most of our time in the same basic set of productivity and communication applications that have existed for a long time. It's word processing, it's spreadsheets, it's presentations, and it's email, which obviously has been complemented by chat and video conference and even social media. And while we all feel more busy and we have more and more communication and digital information coming at us, the reality is that technology has not delivered the same kind of productivity breakthroughs for the knowledge worker to process and act on that increased digital information. And yet the general knowledge worker is the largest TAM that exists in software as a pure size of a demographic. And when you think about the value unlocked to be had by empowering this demographic with software tools that make them on each individual level more productive, more connected to each other, and ultimately happier in their jobs, that value opportunity is massive. And the pure dollars up for grabs to solve that problem are in the hundreds of billions of dollars. Now, you asked about the strategic lens, and I don't think it can be overstated how important this revolution will be for the enterprise software infrastructure, because today, critical business insights really come from the center of enterprise architecture. It's generally applications that drive very little engagement at the outer edge for the knowledge worker. And the future of work and the prize is really about empowering and unlocking this outer edge of the knowledge worker to harness all of the trapped data and knowledge and insights that these individuals have, and ultimately driving enterprise-wide insights and intelligence from that. And for strategics, the lens you have to apply is, if you already sit at the outer edge and have real and engagement with the knowledge worker, you have massive value to be gained by embracing and harnessing this future paradigm. And at the same time, if you don't have engagement or access to this demographic at the outer edge, then you have potentially a real risk of being displaced as the source of business critical insights for your organization.
Okay, so there's a lot of value to be unlocked here and the big prize. What, even though it's still in some ways early days, what's been the impact so far of COVID-19 on some of the trends in workplace technology?
The concept, Jake, of the future of work has existed for years, and innovation and disruption in this ecosystem has been there. And yet COVID has massively accelerated the digital transformation in every organization simply because of the need to support and enable remote work. And the first wave of that transformation really was about addressing and preserving face-to-face communication for the knowledge worker. And that really was mainly video conference communication. While at the same time, on the infrastructure side, that meant investing in resiliency and security to support all of this remote work connectivity. The important aspect of all this transformation, though, is that many believe that this new paradigm of remote work and remote communication is here to stay. And that has massive implications for the future of work and the allocation of resources for small and large businesses around the world. We're starting to see companies that are 100% virtual offices. Many of the largest technology companies in the world have already announced permanent shifts in policy to support remote work well beyond when we expect, hopefully, COVID to resolve itself. And the implications of that is that the dollars that were once spent on expensive real estate are now freed up to spend on technology tools to empower and ultimately amplify the impact of this new remote workforce and connectivity.
So in this massive experiment, we're all working from home, or many of us are, what problems have been revealed or exacerbated regarding technology, workplace technology?
Yeah, even before COVID, Jake, you know, and remote work, most of us can relate to the simple problem that much of our time at work is dealing with simply collaborating and coordinating with our colleagues to get work done. It's about schedules, status checks, calls to share data, and simply finding answers to questions that you wouldn't otherwise be able to find online. And while we're all in the office, much of that was solved by person-to-person interaction. But when we're all remote, that physical shoulder tap doesn't really exist anymore. And the anecdotal data would tell us that we all feel less coordinated, despite even more meetings to get coordinated in this new remote work environment. And the ultimate cost of that is less productivity. That productivity loss is massive and measures in the hundreds of billions of hours a year. That's only exacerbated by COVID and remote work. And ultimately, technology and software will have to be the ultimate bridge to connect and integrate workers with workflow to reduce that productivity tax.
So give us some real world examples around how new software tools, digital workflows will transform the way in which we work.
The most exciting examples, Jake, are probably still in the very early stages and on the come. But what's clear in all the conversations that we have with technologists and technology companies is that the future is going to look a lot different for the knowledge worker than it does today. The software paradigm of the future work is really about software tools and applications that are personalized around us as individuals. So imagine participating in a phone call or video conference where the software automatically captures to-dos from that meeting and tracks progress for you and reminds you of what has to be done. Imagine smart documents that actually have embedded workflows or requirements or actions that will take place well after that document is actually created. Imagine AI tools that simply help you manage your emails and respond proactively to things that just you simply don't have time to get to. All of these kind of tools are coming. And what's exciting to me is that the ecosystem around these applications and these communications to enable this new paradigm and this new nirvana, if you will, of productivity is just starting to really be fostered within organizations and enterprises. And I think that's the real prize at the end of this, is that those who are unable to unlock this future paradigm have massive productivity and value to be gained from it.
Okay, well, so nirvana won't come overnight. Let's stipulate that. What are some of the phases along the way to a better workplace?
I think the first is really about driving and digital workflow and experiences. And so the best examples of that would be today, we turn on video conferencing. We also have things like e-signatures for documents, which is probably one of the best examples of a physical workflow that has just gone pure digital because of this environment. The second is about surfacing real intelligence and insights from those digital workflows. If you think about today, the real work that gets done and the connectivity to the next piece of work that has to get done as a result of that for us as knowledge workers is still very physical, right? It's still very much offline in that you have to let someone else know you're done with that. Either that's an email or a proactive chat. And ultimately, software is going to be able to bridge those connections to be automated. And I think when you start to surface that automation in a way that drives intelligence and insights to ultimately improve those workflows and increase productivity, you then start to unlock why this digital-to-digital workflow and end-to-end communication has real ability to drive productivity for not only the knowledge worker, but for an overall organization. And I think the third aspect of bringing this vision to life is about empowering each one of us as knowledge workers to build our own automation and our own intelligence. And what you have is the platform, because of the end-to-end workflow, because of the insights and the intelligence that's harnessed from that, for us all to describe and define our own inputs and preferences to take action. And I think ultimately that's where the nirvana for us as knowledge workers starts to really come to life, because you think about a smart platform designed around you that ultimately you're telling it, what do I want you to do today for me? And I think that's where you start to unlock the most powerful productivity gains from this entire paradigm of the future of work.
So Ryan, talk a little bit about the obstacles. Traditionally, many IT departments haven't wanted to distribute computing power to the edge, really outside the four walls of the office. Do we need a cultural shift to bring about this sort of transformation?
Historically, I think the premise of your question would be right, Jake. I think what's changing, though, is first off, the cloud computing environment now is an extraordinary enabler of this entire future of work paradigm, because it's easier than ever to push compute power to the edge. And it's even cheaper than ever to do that. I think the other reality is that because of our physical connectivity in the office likely being reduced in the long term because of this experience we're all living through, the bottom line is that IT departments are going to have to fundamentally embrace a new security paradigm and existence for knowledge workers, where they are out of the physical realm of an office or a four-wall controlled environment. And because of that, I think business critical systems and insights and data are ultimately going to have to be pushed out to the edge, even to enable this new future of remote work connectivity. And I think all of those point to an environment where the tailwinds to support this new future work paradigm of remote work, computing at the edge, and access to business critical data is really going to be complementary to the overall challenges of IT departments for the next 5 to 10 years.
So Ryan, talk a little bit about how this new future state of work is playing itself out in your day job as a banker and advisor to companies. Do you see industry consolidation in the future, more M&A, more private capital funding, IPOs from new entrants, new disruptors? Just give us an overview of the state of play from your seat as a banker and advisor to companies in the software space.
Yeah, Jake, and I think the simplest answer is it's all the above, right? What we see first is a massive increase in strategic interest in who are the players that are disrupting this, who are leading in technology and innovation, and ultimately who are winning, you know, the hearts and minds of this demographic, these knowledge workers. I think the second layer that we see is just a massive inflow of capital into private companies who are attacking this opportunity. And that exists both on the early stage for Series A and Series B type investments. But more importantly, it exists on later stage investments where we're seeing significant valuation increases in companies that have had success attacking this opportunity. And I think what's interesting about that, by the way, is that many of those rounds were posted in the height of the COVID crisis, demonstrating that people recognize quickly how valuable this opportunity ultimately is. And then I think on the IPO side and public offerings, you're going to see some very important companies who are early adopters of this goal and this vision come to market with significant valuations that I think are also going to be a telltale sign of how important this market and this opportunity is.
All right, Ryan, thanks for that. Look forward to hearing more from you on this topic, but thanks for joining us today.
That's great. Thanks, Jake, for making time.
To finish up, we'll hear from Tammy Kiely of our investment banking division. She's interviewed Renee James, former president of Intel and current CEO of Ampere Computing, a semiconductor startup. They'll talk about what Renee has learned about how her own employees work best and what they want in the future to stay mentally well and productive.
This is Tammy Kiely from Goldman Sachs, and I'm just delighted today to have one of the busiest people on the planet, Renee James, joining us to share her perspectives on work from home. Renee, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Thanks, Tammy. Thank you for inviting me to talk about this. I'm Renee James. I'm the CEO of Ampere Computing. We're a almost three-year-old in October, startup semiconductor company. All of those things usually don't go in a sentence together, startup semiconductor. And we are building microprocessors for the cloud and having just a ton of fun. I've spent about 28 years working at Intel. A lot of people know me from that. And I have been blessed to be on several boards and am currently a director of some very large companies and spend a lot of time worrying about what is going to happen with employees, both at my own company and others, and how we think about work.
So obviously your main job is leading a semiconductor startup in Silicon Valley. And I know that recently you surveyed your employees about what they want their future of work to look like. And what did the results say?
We were surprised. We've actually surveyed them a couple of times. The first time we surveyed them was when COVID was relatively new, was probably 90 days in, and we kind of thought it might be 6-8 months, maybe a year-long phenomena, who knows. And people were very enthusiastic about working from home. They felt well supported. They were very productive. And it seemed like, hey, maybe working at home forever would be great. We just ran a survey of our population and our employees, not a huge company, but we have about 700 people worldwide. So I'm speaking about, they're kind of two populations because we're global. We have our Asian employees and we have our US employees. The US employees came back and about 46% of them said they'd like to come back to work. But they put qualifications around that. They wanted to come back to work, but they like working at home. What they want is permanent flexibility, which is to say, come to the office 3 days a week, maybe 4 days a week, and work at home, you know, 1 or 2 days a week, or depending on their schedules. Our Asia employees were very much about getting back to work and wanting to be in the office. And especially in India, where they've had a very strict quarantine, they can't come to the office. They very much want to be in the office. And in our other offices like Vietnam and Taiwan and China, everyone's back at work, 100% back at work. So it just really kind of depends where you work.
Gotcha. That makes sense. And how would you contrast that with maybe what you're hearing in the boardrooms of some of the companies that you're involved with? Some of the larger companies.
Well, I think it's kind of interesting because I think we're hearing very similar things, which I find fascinating. You know, in a Fortune 50 company, global company with hundreds of thousands of employees, we're hearing very similar feedback as what we're hearing from, you know, our small sub 1,000 employee company, where employees want to get back to work. Not everyone wants to get back to work. I think some people would like to continue to have flex. Certainly there are people who are like, I could work at home forever, but about 50% of the population now, and I suspect that that could continue to grow, would like to be able to come back to the office. And the reasons that they give are self-consistent. I mean, I see the same kinds of answers across the large scale companies that I'm involved with as I do with our small company, which is certain kinds of work, productivity is better face-to-face, as well as the community and just having a place to go and that isn't your home and, you know, you're part of another family, your work family, and they miss that camaraderie and that time together. So it's, you know, the future of work isn't going to be the same as the past for sure. I don't think we're all going to work at home forever. I think it's going to be somewhere in between. And I think we have to explore what the right hybrids are going to be.
So all of this makes sense. You know, turning to your employee base, what phases are you seeing amongst your employees in terms of their attitudes, their productivity levels, as we're all wrestling with remote work?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I have been trying to draw up something like a Maslow's hierarchy of work at home phases. You know, you don't start with grief, you start with elation because you're so happy. Everyone was really happy, like, oh my gosh, I get to work at home. This is great. There's something about not having to commute. There's something about being able to wear your weekend clothes. And then as things evolve, you realize that, you know, you need to, you're on Zoom or you're on Teams or whatever, and people can see you and you have to actually stage your house or stage your office or get a fake background and do your hair and all this kind of stuff. So there's been an evolution from this is really fun as long as it doesn't last that long to there's are some people who find it very stressful because they don't have enough privacy or they have young children at home and they need to spend time with their kids. So I think as it's worn on, the novelty and the freedom has turned into a little bit of a exhaustion from the back-to-back because there's no commute time, there's no walk time, there's no necessary breaks. So we've had to actually, you know, consciously say to people, you need to take breaks, turn off the camera, you know, make sure you go outside, don't book yourself back-to-back. I think we have reached a point where the combination of the length of time people have been at home, the fact that kids are now going back to school, which is a really big deal that they're not being able to leave the home in many cases, and just the duration, right? I think is starting to wear people down. They're starting to get fatigued.
Yeah. And how does that really, are you seeing that in the productivity levels across your employee base, or how would you characterize that?
I would say that the answer is yes, but the elation phase, which I would call the first 3 or 4 months, was marked by extraordinary productivity. Like in semiconductors, you would measure that by pulling products in. because people were working 24/7 because they had nothing else to do. That's not necessarily healthy, but it's excellent productivity. I think the last 3 months have been more of a getting into more what I call normalized productivity, so not extraordinary. We have not seen a drop in productivity. The companies that I'm on boards for have not seen a real drop in productivity, but we are definitely seeing fatigue set in. So we don't see the extraordinary efforts, which, by the way, I mean, aren't realistic. You know, you can't expect employees to do nothing but work, and it's not healthy for them either. So, I mean, overall, the last 6 months hasn't been bad. I don't know that we can continue. We're getting into a phase where if the workers are either single parents or they have children at home with not a dedicated workspace, we're just getting into places where we're starting to have to make some accommodations for workers at home. And I think this plays into the future of work. I really think it's one of the big topics. How we accommodate them will really define how we use office space going forward and what happens.
I know you and I are both working moms, and you mentioned some of the challenges of having school starting up at home with distance learning. And a lot of us, I know, have the need to wear multiple hats. What other kinds of challenges, or if you want to comment more on that dynamic within what you're seeing in your employees and in the boardrooms?
Yeah, well, I'll start more personally. I have lost my awesome Zoom home office to my teenager who started high school at home and told me I had a better setup. Mom, what is your setup? I said, because I work here. And he's like, but I need it. And I'm like, and of course, because we're parents, right? I'm like, yeah, you should use it. I'll go to like the kitchen table. What? I'm running a company. I'm at the kitchen table because my teenager took over my home office. So we got to rectify that. But everybody is falling into this trap. I mean, one of the things that I'll share with you is that in our company, we have a lot of younger employees. The population demographic is, you know, half of them are under 35-ish. And we have a lot of people with young children. Some aren't even school age. That's one set of issues. But the other is the young kids who need supervision while they're doing remote learning or distance learning. And so we have been asked by employees and are accommodating this that we allow them to shift meetings to after school hours, to take different days, shifts with their spouse or their significant other where they are the monitor, if you will. They're not teaching, but they're monitoring their young children in the morning or on Mondays and Wednesdays, and there's, you know, their significant other's doing it the other days, that kind of thing. So we're accommodating that. The other accommodation that we're making, and by the way, I see that going on in the boardroom. We've been talking a lot about that as well. And I've shared my accommodations because it's easier in a small company with some of the boards I'm on saying, you know, you might want to offer this, right? Because sometimes in a large company, people are a little bit more reticent to ask, could we move these standing meetings to 3 o'clock in the afternoon so I can watch my kids, you know? And look, like, you know, that's life. And they'll work until 9 p.m. I mean, I don't feel like people are cheating the company. You know, people are being very, you know, best efforts, but it's legitimate that they have small children who really do need their help. The other thing that we're doing is we have some people who candidly have, you know, three under the age of six, for example. They cannot really get a lot of work done at home when their kids are awake. So I don't want people going to a public place where they may be exposing themselves and their family to COVID unnecessarily. So our offices are quite clean. We are following all the health protocols. So we're allowing people who need to just come in and work in the office, whether it's one day a week or whatever, just to get that time that they need to get caught up and et cetera. Even where we aren't necessarily fully open, we will let them come in on a case-by-case basis.
That's great. There's a lot of creative ideas in there. That's terrific to hear. And related to the office space that you mentioned, you know, we're seeing big companies like Twitter say that employees can work remotely forever. And so there is a school of thought out there that big companies won't really need big real estate footprints anymore. And would love to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, that is a fascinating example. Thank you for using it because it actually went around at our company. And of course, as you know, I'm private equity and strategic investor backed. And so even my board immediately said to me, well, you guys aren't going to need any real estate, right? What a great way to reduce costs. Wrong. Maybe Twitter can work from home forever. I, you know, bless them if they can. I can't wait to see that work. In semiconductors and in many of the boards I'm on, that doesn't really work. And in our case, we build hardware. So we have labs and we have people who actually physically need to be touching the product and and interacting with it and delivering it to customers and, you know, helping them with the bring up and all that kind of thing. So we're in a business that's more hands-on than a work from home forever kind of scenario. That said, I think we'll have a different use of real estate, if I could. I mean, I think we're going to have more flexible space. We've been talking a lot about, instead of having designated cubes for everyone or set down places, we'll have people use a reservation system, and that will keep us from maybe having to expand sooner. And it might allow some larger companies to shrink their footprint, but I don't think they'll be getting rid of all of their space. And it depends what kind of business you're in. I mean, certainly if you're Boeing, you're probably going to actually need to continue to build planes in big places. The more manufacturing oriented companies, it's harder. It's harder for us. But for the white collar office worker and knowledge workers, we're going to have the ability to kind of have more flexible space, I think, for sure.
Well, certainly interesting times, Renee. Really appreciate you spending the time out of your day to catch up with us. And good luck with the rest of dealing with the pandemic and other things. But thanks again for your time.
Yeah, thanks for asking me. I appreciate it.
Thank you for listening, and please tune into the next episode of this miniseries about the ways the pandemic has changed how we connect socially, from Facebook to TikTok and beyond. This podcast was recorded throughout the month of August and September in the year 2020. Thanks for listening.
All price references and market forecasts correspond to the date of this recording. This podcast should not be copied, distributed, published, or reproduced in whole or in part. The information contained in this podcast does not constitute research or a recommendation from any Goldman Sachs entity to the listener. Neither Goldman Sachs nor any of its affiliates makes any representation or warranty as to the accuracy or completeness of the statements or any information contained in this podcast, and any liability, therefore, including in respect of direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage, is expressly disclaimed. The views expressed in this podcast are not necessarily those of Goldman Sachs, and Goldman Sachs is not providing any financial, economic, legal, accounting, or tax advice or recommendations in this podcast. In addition, the receipt of this podcast by any listener is not to be taken as constituting the giving of investment advice by Goldman Sachs to that listener, nor to constitute such person a client of any Goldman Sachs entity.